the most beautiful place in the world, where a Tar Heel blue sky blankets Murphy on its way to the Tennessee border. It's a long way from Raleigh and the Outer Banks, but we're living in Carolina too. In fact, you might call it extreme Carolina. With more, here's Michael Borkman.
Well, hello again. This is Michael Borkman with Extreme Carolina, where we talk about topics and newsmakers that happen in Clay and Cherokee County. And today, we are very fortunate to have with us someone with the Forestry Service, but I may say that wrong, but I'm going to get his name right. It's Kent Nelson, and he's here helping us fight these fires that we're having. So we thought we'd do a special program on that and come right at you with this. So I'll just introduce him again, Mr. Kent Nelson. Welcome.
Well, good to be here. Thanks for having me.
Oh, it's our pleasure.
I'm a public information officer with the Southern Area Incident Management Team, and we're here to help manage some of the wildfires in the area. Right now, we've got about 17 fires that we're responsible for.
Wow. 17? I mean, actual separate fires.
Yeah, that spread out a couple of counties and over 4,000 acres.
Wow. That's amazing. One of the questions that I want to get to right away is that your job description. What are the duties of a public information officer? I want to make sure we get that right off the bat.
Okay, that's a great way to start. Well, there's about six or eight of us that are working on the fire. And what we want to do is make sure that the public knows what's going on.
Okay.
That's the short version.
We like short. Short is good.
We do that by doing interviews like this, and we provide maps and posters and updates at key locations around where the fire is active.
Okay.
So people, if they're going to the grocery store, they can see where the fire is in relation to their house, like that.
Awesome. Okay. Well, now let me ask you another question along the lines of the agencies of the people that you're working with. What agencies do you speak on behalf of, if I can ask that?
Well, it's kind of complicated, but in short, our incident management team is brought here by the National Forest.
Okay.
That's who kind of works.
Coordinated.
But we work with the local forestry departments and the local fire departments. We kind of help manage the incident.
Awesome. Okay, so are they like a national organization, or would that be in one state, or the each state have their own forestry or?
Well, each state has their own forestry service, but an incident management team. There's only 16 of them in the whole United States, so this is kind of a privilege to be here, and we need to be here, and we're glad to help.
Awesome. Awesome. It's interesting you say that you're privileged to be here. We're actually are super glad that you're here. I mean, we truly are. We're honored to have you guys here. We want to do all we can to help facilitate making sure that you guys have everything you need.
That's great.
And do the things that we can for you. As of this morning, which is 11/8/16, I know this will be dated by the time everybody hear it, but as of this morning, what I want to ask, though, is, and you said there are like 16, 17 reported fires. Is that correct? In our counties of Clay and Cherokee County. So there's 17 fires now. But these fires are not yet in North Georgia. They're all contained in Western North Carolina. Is that correct?
Yeah, it may be a little bit confusing to your listeners, but the area that I work in is only in North Carolina.
Okay.
So I don't know much about the fires in Georgia.
Good. Well, we're not talking to them anyway.
Well, but I would be concerned. I'm sure they're having some activity.
Yeah, because it's pretty close.
Drought.
Yeah, yeah, it's pretty close. Okay. So then you made a – and I want to backtrack just a little bit just to – who coordinates all of these services? I mean, I know there's like 16 of your type of service that travels around the country. But who makes sure that these services or coordinates them all? Who is that? Is there one at the top or like three or four?
Well, I don't know how it works from that level.
Mm-hmm.
But we're certainly in touch with the local senators, and we had the governor visit us. I mean, there's definitely a lot of officials that know what's going on and are glad we're here.
Well, the reason that I'm asking that, because there has to be a strategic plan to combat fighting these fires. So someone has to, a command has to be together, I mean, or has to set up, and from that disseminate the workers to go on in various
places. That's what we do.
Ah.
So that's why I wasn't getting you. Yeah, okay. That's what we do.
That's what you got.
We put out a plan every day, and we have a briefing in the morning. We assign the different crews what fire they're going to work on based on priorities.
Okay.
You know, how many, and you know what a priority fire would be?
Tell us.
One that's threatening homes.
Uh-huh. Now, that's a question that I'm very interested in because I could actually, I mean, the ridge behind my house, if I can say that, over in Clay County, I mean, it's like right over the ridge. I mean, you could see the smoke, and we smell it every day. I mean, it's like thick.
It's pretty scary.
Yeah, very
scary. People
aren't
used to it. I mean, nope. These type of teams, we work on fires all over the country,
mm-hmm.
and you know, most of the time we're out west in Montana, Idaho, but to be here on the East Coast and have these kind of conditions is very unusual.
Very unusual. Okay. Well, it's a good thing you guys are skilled and know how to fight these fires. Let me ask you this. Which fires are currently the most threatening or dangerous?
Most of the fires are in probably the northern part of Clay County that are really the most threatening, but okay. Baudelaire, which is near Hayesville.
Right, yeah,
right in my area. That was kicking up a little bit of smoke yesterday. I don't know if you saw that.
I did, yeah.
And so what we're doing today primarily is trying to get things, what we call buttoned up, you know, make sure mm-hmm. that the containment lines are strengthened and that the fire won't escape because we're expecting a lot of wind in the next few days.
I have a question along those lines, but before I get to that, let me kind of reset this real quick. Today, thanks everyone for tuning in to Extreme Carolina. We have today with us Mr. Kent Nelson, and he is talking with us about the fires that we're currently having here in our area. And so we're very appreciative that he could come on and talk with us a little bit. Now, my next question for you, Kent, would be now, what's the approximate number of local and state national personnel that deployed to fight these fires in our area? Is there approximate number?
Yeah, we're looking at, I think we're around 350, maybe close to 400. There was still people coming in last night at 9:30.
Wow.
And we've got 38 states represented.
Whoa.
You know, some of the firefighters came as far as Alaska to help out.
Wow. That is amazing. I mean, just to jump on a plane or jump in your car, what more like a plane, to come and fight a fire, that takes a special type of person to do that. I'm not that guy.
Hey, you're helping us get the word out. That's part of it. You know, you're helping the people understand that we got a serious situation here with this drought and this fire activity.
Yeah, we hadn't seen rain. I mean, we actually went up to the fire a week ago to see it. You know, and like, wow, this is serious. And because we were seeing the helicopters flying over and they were having strange looking things hanging from the bottom of them. I guess that sucks it go down to the lake.
Oh, yes.
What would they be called?
It's those are our heavy helicopters, and they can hold like 1,000 gallons of water, and it's got suction line.
Okay,
and it looks like a big insect, doesn't it?
It does.
Know, like a mosquito, spider. Right?
Well, you know, we were talking about that at work the other day. But like these rumors going flying hot and heavy. We were up to those things would tote 2,000 gallons. No, that's heavy. I mean, 8
right.
pounds per gallon or something.
That's
like that.
Right. You did your research, didn't you? Yeah, that's a lot of weight.
That's a lot of weight, man. I mean, you would need those really big ones like the Army would use, which, by the way, if this fire is so hugely, and it is, why aren't we using more resources to get that sort of thing? Or is it too late for that, and now we just have to contain? Or is that where
we have 4 helicopters assigned.
Okay.
And these helicopters are specially outfitted for wildland fires. Whereas your military, they might be able to put on a what we call a Bambi bucket, which is like a bucket that can hold maybe 250 gallons.
Oh, that's
now, if you got a fire on that ridge behind your house, do you want 1,000 gallons on it or you want 250?
You got me, bro. I want 1,000. Well, I tell you what, we're coming up on the stop part here, so I don't want to go over. Besides that, we want our our commercial people to get in and do their thing. So, again, we're here with Mr. Kent Nelson, and we'll be back on the other side of the commercial, and we'll talk a little bit more about fighting fires in just a minute. Thank you all. Be right back.
Tar Heel basketball, Cam's Panthers, Asheville's eclectic nightlife, and the Great Smoky Mountains. It belongs to us, too, out here in extreme Carolina. Once again, here's Michael Borkman.
All right, we're back once again here in extreme Carolina with our guest today, the gentleman Kent Nelson from the Incident Management Team. They fight incidences all over the country. And I learned that there were like 16 teams that go all over the country. This is new for them over here in eastern part of the country. And we're glad that they're here, but we don't want to see them because that means if we see them, it's an incident going on. It's not a good thing. But anyway, we want to get back to the questions that we have for you. And we had some folks, we let them know that we were going to be talking to you all, and they actually sent us some questions.
Oh, good. Great. Guys.
So we want to make sure that our local citizens are well aware of what's going on because this is serious. We never get this sort of thing like they get out west, like you were telling me off air, that this is a I wouldn't say common, but it's way more common out there than it is on this side of the
country. That's correct.
Okay. And so it takes some special people to fight this type of fire because we're not used to seeing something like this. So that's why the folks off the air, you said as far away as Alaska?
Yeah.
That
yeah.
came in?
Yep.
And so that's like over 300. I think you said the number early on the other side. It's like up to now, it's like 350. That's here in terms of bodies help fighting
right,
fire.
Right, right.
So, okay, well, great. Well, I tell you what, let's jump into the next one because the next one is someone sent this question in, and the question was, we have heard unconfirmed reports that there is a fire in George Kilmer Memorial Forest. Now, Kent, can you confirm this? And if so, how much of the park is involved? If so, it's especially tragic as this is the only true virgin forest in the southern Appalachians.
Wow. Well, we get a lot of calls from outside of the national forest that we're assigned to, mm-hmm. and I think this is a little bit outside, but I can little give you a little background on the
please do.
On how this fire behaves.
Okay.
I don't know if any of you folks out there have seen this fire, but it's fairly low mm-hmm. to the ground. We call it a surface fire, and it's burning a lot of leaves and stuff on the ground. If that type of fire gets into this this wilderness area or this protected area, mm-hmm. It may not do that much damage to the big trees.
Really?
The big trees have thick bark, mm-hmm. and when I say big, I'm using my hands here, but you can't yeah. see them. But, you know, I'm right. you know 2 feet, 3 feet in diameter.
Wow.
Those trees are not going to really be hurt by a slow-moving ground fire.
Right. Well, I've seen that that forest, and 2 and 3 feet, those are small trees.
Okay, there's some
they
big
got
trees.
Some really yeah. big ones. I guess like you have out west or redwoods.
Oh,
I
wow.
mean, that are like 6-7 people around.
Nice.
That's yeah, how big yeah. some of these trees are.
You know, not having been there, I don't know for sure, but just in general, this type of fire behavior doesn't threaten big trees. It does right. not get up in the crowns.
Right.
So, but it right. could threaten your house. Maybe that's one of your next questions.
Yes, that is. So if you would just answer that, is this type of fire, it will envelop houses quicker than it would the trees? Is that what you're saying?
Yes. The way we're trained is anything that burns is called a fuel.
Okay.
And so when I say fuel, I don't mean just gasoline. I mean like wood. Anything combustible.
Right.
Well, your house is a fuel. The fire doesn't know whether it's a tree or whether it's brush. It's wood.
Got it.
So we ask people to try to keep leaves and any kind of wood debris away from all your structures.
Sound
like 30 feet away.
Sound like I'm going to be raking leaves.
Yeah, even a leaf blower, something. Get that okay. stuff away because if you have a surface fire coming from the woods
okay.
towards your house and it's got fuel to burn, mm-hmm. It's not going to stop till it gets to your house.
Wow.
But you can, even 15 minutes can rake that leaves about right. away from your house,
away
and that could
house.
Help save it.
That
so
help
keep
save
that in mind.
House. So the fire's coming over the ridge, and it's just burning stuff that's low to the ground, leaves, wood, but if it gets close to the house, house is gone. So what we could do is keep that stuff away from the house.
Yeah, and you want to do that before the fire is within sight, obviously. Right. But do it now. Do it this weekend.
Yeah, I'll be doing that.
You know, I mean, you know, the game's on in the afternoon. You got all morning.
Yes, you're right. I have a feeling I will be out there long before the game comes on. But anyway, I want to reset this, y'all, once again with everyone here at Extreme Carolina. We are privileged to have with us today, came all the way to the studio with us, Mr. Kent Nelson. He's with the incident management team. And so we're going to continue on with our questions. And this is great. Thank you so very much, Mr. Nelson. We really appreciate you taking the time out of fighting fires to come and talk to us. And now I have another question that was sent in for us for me to ask you.
Sure.
And it is, we see the helicopters carrying water in Clay County. What can you tell us about these aircraft and the pilots who fly them hour after hour?
Oh, those things are fascinating. I mean, we get a lot of pictures sent to our Facebook page and stuff about those helicopters. It's not something you see every year.
No.
These helicopter pilots, most of them are veterans. You know, they serve time in the military. Not always the case, but they've got thousands and thousands of hours in training. In flying.
Okay.
These are the cream of the crop.
Wow. Top guys.
Because they got to manage this load, and they got to put it, you know, 1,000 gallons of water in a spot as big as a trash can sometimes. Well, I mean, they take pride in their aim.
A spot as big as a garbage.
Sometimes, yeah. If they've got something burning, they'll try to get real pinpoint accuracy.
Wow. Now that's amazing. So now, do you have, like, in NASCAR, you got spotters, you know, talking to these guys, or they just got to do it as they're flying and fly over it and see it and then pull their lever and drop it?
No, great question. We've got guys on the ground, so we've got ground-to-air radio transmissions, and they're bringing them in because they want to tell them where they can be most effective.
Right.
You know, we're having trouble with this hot spot right here. It's flaring up. Can you hit this spot right here?
Awesome.
And they'll signal to them. They'll talk them in. And they'll get the firefighters out of the way.
Got it.
Because you don't want to be hit with that water.
That would hurt.
You'll be squashed like a bug.
Wow. 1,000 gallons on your head. That would not be pretty. That would hurt for a long time.
Right. But, you know, one thing's a little misleading is people think that these helicopters do all the work.
Right.
They don't.
They're
just knocking down the head, the front of the fire.
Okay.
You got to have firefighters on the ground.
On the ground.
To clean it up, mop it up. So those are the guys that I have a lot of respect for. They're out there climbing these mountains in the dirt, in the smoke, putting these fires out.
Speaking of that, climbing the mountain, I mean, the ones that are right over in the north part of Clay County, there is no... We could only see it. There were no paths up to it.
Right.
So how difficult is it for the firefighters to get up to the fire and make a ditch or whatever to contain it?
It's tough. And we have pretty strict physical fitness requirements. And, you know, these guys and gals are trained.
Wow.
And ready to go. I mean, that's what they do.
Wow. Well, I guess I couldn't put in my application because I am not physically.
Oh, yeah. You got the drive, I'm sure.
Wow. So with that said then, because I want to make sure that we get the questions in. And thanks, by the way. Man, these are some serious answers that you're giving us. Now, how can local citizens support the effort of these who are battling these fires, these guys and gals you just talked about?
Well, we really appreciate that question. And we get that a lot, actually. But, you know, the state and federal firefighters, we're pretty well taken care of. You know, we have a finance division within our incident management team that's taking care of,
awesome.
Of making sure we have what we need to eat, and lodging, that kind of thing.
Fantastic.
So, you know, we don't really need that stuff, but we would rather have the donations and the time given to the local volunteer fire departments.
Okay.
Those folks, they've already done their day job for 8 or 10 hours.
Right.
And then they're asked to go out and investigate and work on a fire at night.
Wow.
Those are the people that we want the efforts to go to. So if you get a chance to stop by your local fire department, that's where you should see if you can help out with some extra water.
Fantastic.
Cookies, whatever.
Awesome. We will make sure that's up on our Facebook page to talk about that. Last one. What can we expect to see over the next several days and weeks in terms of the fire spreading and the containment efforts?
Oh, okay. Well, we're doing a lot of work today to try to manage the containment lines and make sure everything's kind of buttoned up, as I was saying before.
Right.
Because we're expecting some winds coming in.
Yes.
And that's may wreak a little havoc.
Okay.
But we don't see any rain in sight. I mean, we might be here for a couple of weeks. We might be here till December. Who knows? Wow. But we're doing our best to make things safe for you folks, and we appreciate the opportunity to talk about it.
Well, thank you for coming in. We appreciate that, sir. Again, we've had today with us Mr. Kent Nelson from Incident Management Team. We really appreciate it. Coming to Extreme Carolina to talk to us, where we talk about the incidences as well as topics of going on in Clay and Cherokee counties. Again, we are very blessed to have him here today. Thank you all. You all have a great day. Go out and make someone smile and have a super, super day. God bless. We'll talk to you soon. Bye now.
Heading down south to the land of the pines. I'm thumbing my way into North Carolina. Staring off the road and pray to God I see headlights. I made it down the coast in 17 hours, picking me a bouquet of dogwood flowers. And I'm hoping for Raleigh, I can see my baby tonight.